1 Corinthians chapter 15 we're going to be turning to this evening. And if you're wondering, my mum got safely off about an hour ago. I dropped off at the airport. I'm not sure if she's on the plane yet. I think she's still waiting around for the plane to be boarded. But she's flying back this evening, so appreciate prayerful support for her. And she had a good time. The week flies, as it always does, when you've got your family with you. But it's good to have time there with the children and with mum. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, just a couple of verses this evening as we turn to our Bible study. We're moving into this wonderful chapter. It's remarkable. And we're going to be in this chapter for some time. I can't really tell you how long, but I know just by looking ahead and looking at these different messages and different subjects which come to us, we're going to be certainly probably spending more time in this chapter than we've given to any of the previous chapters, and rightly so, because it's a treasure chest, we might say. There's so much for you to learn, so much for me to teach you, and for all of us to learn together as a church. And I really prayed at the end of the chapter that our hearts are certainly revived and refreshed as we think of the glorious crescendo with which it finishes. And then we've got chapter 16 to go through as well, but in many respects, they're the two very different chapters. This evening, just the first two verses I want to read with you before we come to our Bible study. And as we look at the chapter 15 and we move into really a new realm, a new subject and a new material that Paul deals with, I want us to think about the need to sift, as Paul does, the professing church, sifting the professing church. And that's precisely what we find here in these opening verses. So 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 1 and 2. And Paul writes these words. He says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain." We'll finish there at verse number 2. So 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 and 2. Now, Paul's final words in this magnificent chapter, they provide for us a very fitting summary of the whole chapter in many respects. So if we were to turn to the end of chapter 15, and it's going to seem like a long time until we get to the end of chapter 15, but those very well-known verses at the very end, when he says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren," and then he says this, "be steadfast, unmovable," and so on. Those words in that final verse, they are a very apt way of describing the entirety of the chapter, and in many ways, the entirety of the letter that we've been dealing with for some time. Because what do we find that Paul is doing throughout this great letter? He's reminding the church of Corinth, and he's reminding believers that the faith of God's people is to be a steadfast faith. And the faith of God's people is to be an unmoving or an unmovable faith. Now, the moment that Paul will say such things as this, there is the immediate sense in which we realize, well, there's going to be things that are going to try to move our faith. And there are going to be those influences and those false teachings. And they're going to try to shift us. And they're going to try to nudge us and move us off course. And so when the word of God calls, Christian, when the word of God calls us to be steadfast, it's because there are many influences that are going against us. And there are many influences, wicked influences, that want us to be derailed in the Christian life. So what he says at the end, and we'll get to there eventually, is a very good way of just helping us understand the entirety of chapter 15 this evening. And as we do that, I want you to keep three things in mind. This is the introduction, by the way, so don't be getting excited when I get to the end of these three things. Just, I want three principles for you to keep in mind as we begin to work our way through chapter 15. The first thing to remember this evening is that Paul is moving into a new subject. So we're done with the tongues. We've moved on from Christian love. We've dealt with so many things in the chapter. It doesn't mean that the previous chapters in chapter 15 are now, you know, unrelated, because this is all one letter and it flows naturally one chapter into the other. But it's very clear to see that when he says, "Moreover," in verse 1, that what Paul is saying is this: in addition to everything else, I have to bring this to your attention. That's what he means when he says, moreover. So everything else that I've been dealing with, we haven't finished. Not by any stretch of the imagination. There is much more for us to be learning. And far from thinking that what Paul does at the end is sort of, you know, it's just an add-on. It's just a small thing to wrap things up with. No, not at all. This is, in many respects, the most important thing. What we're dealing here in chapter 15 is foundational to our faith. But I want you to keep that in mind. It is a new subject we're dealing with in chapter 15. So then secondly, the main area of contention within the chapter is surrounding those who denied the doctrine of the resurrection of the saints. Now, again, something to keep in mind. Paul is not dealing primarily with any that were rising up denying the resurrection of Christ. What he will say, as you will see in a moment, is that the two things are connected. But what he's addressing primarily is this: there are those who have been raised up among the ranks of the Corinthian believers, and while they may have agreed to the fact that Christ had risen from the dead, they did not think that the saints would physically rise again. It's what we call the general resurrection of the dead. There was a denial of that. We don't know which direction this came from. We can't be dogmatic. Some suggest it came from a Sadducee influence. There may have been those who had made a profession from out of the Sadducees, that particular sect and group, and they had made some profession of Christ, but they now began to sow their false teaching, their seeds, amongst the people in Corinth, and it was very unhealthy teaching, erroneous teaching. Others suggest that it was actually influenced from the Greek philosophers. You remember in Acts, whenever Paul was mocked and he was laughed at, he was despised because he preached the resurrection from the dead. And they said, you're a foolish man, Paul. Why would you believe and think such things? So here the church is established in Corinth, and here is Greek philosophy, and they've come along and they have put a big question mark over teaching of the resurrection of the dead. We don't know where this influence came from. Probably one of those two areas, maybe a combination of the both. But what we do know from the likes of verse 12, if you look at verse 12, is that it was influencing some, but it wasn't influencing all of them. And there were some that were sowing the seeds of error, false teaching, but not all of them. And so verse 12, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you? So it's a good thing this wasn't, you know, the entirety of the church that it was contaminating, but it was still a problem because some had to be addressed. That's the second thing to keep in mind. The third one before we move into our main headings is this: that Paul's thinking and reasoning throughout is critical to follow. How are we going to address the problems that we're going to face in this chapter? Well, what does Paul do? He does this. He lays down a marker throughout the chapter time and time again, and we'll get to it in time. And he says this: to deny the physical resurrection of the dead is essentially to deny the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Whether people actually came out and say that doesn't really matter. Paul is saying the two are so entwined together, you must have one to have the other. And you're going to find that as we go through the chapter, this is one of his leading arguments throughout. That being the core of the chapter, Paul begins in verses 1 and 2 by bringing a rebuke, we might say. That's how we're going to start these messages this evening. It's a gentle, but it's a necessary rebuke. And what he does in verses 1 and 2, it might not be earth-shattering to some people. You look at these words and you say, well, what's so special about these words? Christian, this evening, everything is special about them. Everything, because where we begin in verses 1 and 2 is going to dictate how we continue in this chapter. And let me say, everything we believe as Christians, everything that we hold dear as believers on the authority of the Word of God, it finds a foundation here within these words, because in verses 1 and 2, it's all about sifting. It's all about measuring them. It's all about saying, well, where do you really stand when it comes to the gospel? You say you're a Christian. Do you know what you believe? Do you know what you're following? You know, that's in many ways the essence of what verse 1 and verse 2 are all about. And so it's an important beginning. And I don't want to rush through this chapter in any way, shape or form. So sifting the professing church, we see how he does this in a number of ways. First of all, by declaring what has already been preached. Some people call that being repetitious. It's not for Paul when you think about what he's doing here. Notice what he says in verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. Paul, not the gospel again. We know the gospel. You know, Christians think like that, don't they? We don't need to hear the gospel because I've been saved for 10, 12, 20, 30 years. We need something else. That's because the poverty of some people's understanding is to think like this, that the gospel is only for unsaved people and it can do the Christian no good. Wherein the Bible makes it very clear that our sanctification and our growth and our development is all found in knowing this more and more. And never being content with just thinking, because we believe, that's it. Now we've got to look into the spectacular things and the sensational things within the Bible. No, know the gospel if we're to know anything. And so Paul is making this his starting point. I declare to you the gospel which I preached unto you. So what you can do, believer, this evening is when you look at chapter 15, it's like an expansion of the gospel. And that for me is a challenging, because we have to move on from thinking the gospel is I'm a sinner, Jesus died for me and I can go to heaven. Well, yeah, in simple form, that's what it is. But Paul develops right throughout these, 58 verses, multitude of themes, the two Adams, immortality, the resurrection of the dead, all of these things. And he says, I'm declaring this unto you, what I've already told you, I'm going to say it again. Because somewhere along the line you've missed it, and you've let yourself go in a sense. Put it this way: what Paul is saying in verse 1 is, "I am making known to you what I've already made known to you through my preaching." We have to get ourselves back on track. I wonder this evening if any of us are in this need. We've derailed a little bit as a Christian. We've gone astray. We have to get back to these things. As he does this, as he declares what has already been preached by Paul, he makes it clear that two things haven't changed. His message hasn't changed. Look at verse 1. He says, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you. And again, nestled between those two actions is a message that knows no change and must never be changed. The gospel of our blessed Savior. You know, when God is pleased to sift you and to sift me as believers and as a church and all of his people, he will do so through the ministry of God's holy word. I'm not saying that he will not use other means. He will. Providential dealings, circumstances and so on. But there is nothing quite like when God takes the word of God to change us. And that's what it takes for Corinth. Getting back to this glorious gospel that he's going to declare and he's going to make known unto them. Because when we take the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ and we expound it and we make it known and we develop it and we apply it, it does for us what nothing else can do. No human word can do. No human action can do. And it's so clear that for Corinth, there were many issues which it had at this stage in history, and it was unstable and it was contentious and it was disorderly and it wasn't good. And so Paul, faced with all of these things, you could almost imagine, you know, in today's age, people coming together, whether it's elders, whether it's a committee, or whether it's just a group of presbyters or something along those lines, how are we going to sort all of these things out? And Paul rises up and he says, do you know what's missing from this? We've lost a hold of what Christ has done and all that he is. And we're trying to fix problems any other way and every other way and not this way. I'm not getting back to this. So Paul stands up and he says, I'm getting back to this. I'm going to declare it and I'm going to tell you exactly what you believe and what must be believed. And that message hasn't changed. And that applies to today, doesn't it? And you know what it applies to the end of our year and 10 years' time and whatever comes and goes? This message cannot change. It is the everlasting gospel because it comes from the everlasting God. And then in tandem with that, as he declares what he's already made known, his ministry hasn't changed because he identifies the channel or the means by which this message is going to come. And he says in verse 1, which I preached unto you. And he says, I'm going to preach it again. I'm going to declare what I preached. In other words, I'm going to preach what I preach. And I'm going to keep on doing it. Because it has pleased God, as he said elsewhere. And we've dealt with this through the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe, but also to sanctify them that believe at the same time. And that's very important for us to keep in mind this evening. Because even if in Corinth there had been a great deviation and a moving away from the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ, Paul was not going to do this. And so when he brings this back to their attention, it's almost, for some, it's going to be as if they've heard it for the first time. I believe that's how bad things were in Corinth. That when Paul brings the truth of the gospel to their conscience, for some who had drifted so far away, it's as if they've heard it for the first time. That's quite an alarming thing when you hear messages like this and you say, well, that's just something like I've never heard before. Might be an indication of how far away we've got. That's what it was for Corinth. Remember in the times of the Reformation era, in times of revival, the preaching of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ was what God used. Not something new and not something novel. And the need of the hour is not novel and not new, it's the renewal of gospel power. And of all the ways that Paul begins this, he starts here. By reminding them and by declaring unto them what he had already preached. And even if some are going to say, not again, Paul, he says, no, again, you need to hear this. This is fundamental. This is what sifts the professing church. Well, he does also something else to sift the professing church. He then reinforces what had been received. So what he does now when he begins to declare and preach, he says, okay, you've received this. And I'm going to reinforce into your mind and your heart what you've received. I'm going to remind you of what you said you believe. And again, he doesn't do it in these verses, but he's going to be doing that over the course of the chapter. And again, we must make clear here that when Paul writes to the church in Corinth in his letter, he is viewing them as a whole. We've mentioned that already, as a body of professing believers. He is confident that a good number of them are saved. And there are those, of course, who have raised the alarm to the Apostle Paul. But there were the some. And among the some, there were those that were troublesome and those that were troubled and those that were divisive and those that were divided. And add to this all the previous errors of pride and arrogance and confusion and all the other things that we've been dealing with within this chapter, it was not a healthy church. I think simply there were those present that weren't regenerate. And I always believe that we've got to be quite frank and open as a Christian church that we may well be in a day and age where people sit in the churches and they're still not saved. And they've never embraced this gospel. They just don't know it. They know of it, they've heard it, but it hasn't really done anything for them. And others are saved, but they're so influenced away. And others are being contended against, and it's messy. It's hard. So here he is, and he reinforces everything that this church has said at the beginning. We believe. Do you really? Really believe this? That's why Christian confessions of faith and articles of faith, of course, we subscribe to the Westminster Confession of Faith and the Shorter Catechism and so on, that they're so important to us. And more than you realize, and encourage you to read them when you can, they will never replace the Word of God. We don't believe that. But we recognize that they formulate and they give to us the truth of God in such a way that it clearly outlines what the Scripture teaches so that we can go back and say, here are the things that we hold to. And the things that we believe to be true. Being evasive, being mysterious, being hesitant as to what is believed, not believed is dangerous. And Paul is making it clear here in verse 1. I declare unto you the gospel which I preached, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand. This is a very solid start to this whole chapter that Paul is giving us here. Paul has in mind, as I've indicated, and we'll look at in time, the doctrine of the resurrection of the dead in the general sense. His preaching has already brought men and women to Christ living and dying and rising again according to the scriptures, but it's this which is in his mind. And he says in verse 1, which you've received. Now that's the thing that really grips me. Because he's working upon this assumption, he's working upon this thought here. And he's writing to people in a general sense, he says, okay, you've received this. Have you really received it? Do you know what's in your heart? Do you know the things that you must believe? And it's a powerful challenge. Here were people who had subscribed at least by their mouth, and we hope in their hearts to the gospel. And he says, do you remember this? This gospel that you received, do you realize it's under attack? It's under approach? It's under scrutiny? Are you allowing this just to drift by if you received this in vain? And to strengthen his challenge, he assumes that this is not only what they believe, past tense, but it's what they now stood for. And he says, it's what you've received and it's wherein you stand. Don't you know the very things that your foundation is and what your hope is built upon? And everything that you believe, it's the attempts are being made to be taking it away from under your feet. And it seems as if you're caught up in so much more, as we've dealt with in this chapter, that you're missing this. You're missing it altogether. And he wants to pull them back from the brink and pull them back from potential ruination. Do you not know this, he says? You've built your life on the firm foundation of a risen Christ, and now here are some who've entered in, and by their pernicious teaching, they're subtly destroying all of these things. I say, Christian, we all do well not just to look over and back on what we first received and believed in our conversation, but what we stand on and what we stand for. And those are challenges. They're going to be sifting by their very nature. They're going to try us and they're going to examine us. Our Lord Jesus himself did this very thing. John 6, verses 66 and 67, when many of the disciples from that time went back and they walked no more. So the Lord turns to the 12 and he says, will he also go away? And it's akin to what Paul is saying here. You've received this. Do you stand for it? Do you believe it? Again, these are all introductory remarks, but the design of Paul in verses 1 and 2 is to grab their attention, because I think their attention was everywhere else. I really do. I think when you factor in those 14 chapters and the mess that the church was in, they were so taken up with things of no consequence. Some things were very important he dealt with, and there was error he dealt with, but all the mess. And he says, you don't see it. That which you've received is being taken from you. You've got to stand again upon these things. And so he sifts them. And then lastly, as he sifts the professing church, he does so by exhorting and encouraging an effective faith. And I believe verse 2 is along those lines. By which also ye are saved. Then he says this, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. Now that last verse requires a little bit of thinking to clear up any problems that we might have with it. Now, in our authorized version, in our King James Bible, we have the phrase, if you keep in memory. Now, possibly, and this is the general consensus, by the way, this is not me coming with a chisel and a hammer and knife to scripture, this is the general consensus of all that believe these things and study well the scriptures and hold to the authorized version, that particular sentence and phrase could maybe be read a little bit differently to help us. Because today we take that thought of, if you keep in memory, and the thought is, well, if you just remember these things, you'll be okay. But it's much more than this. Let me try to explain why. For example, that phrase, if you keep in memory, that the same Greek words that we have in the Holy Scriptures are translated elsewhere along these lines, okay? So the sentence, if you keep in memory, is translated in Matthew 21:38, let us seize on. So it's the idea of seizing. Okay, so already it's a stronger meaning, just remembering. Romans 1:18, it's translated the Greek word who hold. The same Greek word that we have memory or keeping memory is translated in 1 Corinthians 7:30 as possessed. So you put those together, Christian, you've already got a very different picture that reads something along those lines. In verse 2, he says, by which ye are also saved if you hold fast. If you hold fast. If you retain. If you possess. If you seize. You see, Christian, that's the character of the child of God. And that's incredibly challenging. Because we all understand how easy it is to grow weak and weary in the Christian life, and how erosion can set in against the things that we believe, and little things here and there, they easily creep in and they begin to eat away at sound doctrine, sound teaching. And before we know it, all sorts of strange things are entering into our minds. And Paul says, what are you doing here? He says, you're saved, and yet part of your salvation is to hold fast and to be strong and to be bold and courageous. And that's missing in so many respects in pulpit and pews in these days in which we live. Of course, you do all of that in the right character, in the right frame of mind, and the right demeanor, and the right Christian love, and all those added things we've dealt with. But you do all that and you hold fast. And today we see so little of God's people holding fast in these days. The call of the gospel is not simply to believe. The call of the gospel is not simply to receive. The call of the gospel of Jesus Christ is to hold fast and to be strong in the grace which is in our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, when the Lord speaks to his church to shake it, to sift it, it's what he does. He says, you've received it, you've professed, but are you holding on? Are you sure and steadfast? Hebrews 10:23, again, the same Greek wording reads along these lines. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. That's the picture you've got to keep getting in your mind here. It's bringing lots of things into play. Holding fast what we confessed without the wavering. It's a lot there to take on board, but that's what you've got to do by the grace of God. It's a clear exhortation to encourage them, to stir the church into a life which maybe it had forgotten, and a lull and a deadness and an apathy was at large. And then he goes on to speak about this. He says, by which ye are also saved. Now, look at verse 2, by which also you're saved. And by using the present tense, that's what you've got here, Paul draws attention to the certainty of the believer's salvation. It's wonderful, isn't it? By which ye are also saved. There's many more years to go before the Lord calls them out of this world, but he says you're saved. His gospel saved you. What causes a bit of confusion for some is the presence of the word if in verse 2. So he says, by which also ye are saved, if ye hold fast, or if you keep in memory. Now, some will come to that and say, well, that means you're only saved if you hold yourself or you hold on to salvation. Well, that's not what we believe. That's not the teaching of Holy Scripture. We would certainly not teach, because the Bible does not teach that we hold on to our own salvation or we hold on to Christ in that sense. It's not our strength and our ability that keeps us at the end of the day. However, we do not believe this as well. We do not believe and hold to a form of Christianity that teaches that it's just a matter of believing and receiving and that's just fine. We'll just carry on and live as we are. No. We don't believe that either. What we believe is precisely what the Scripture is saying here. We call it in Reformed theology the perseverance of the saints. It's a very important teaching within the Holy Scripture. And we make no apology for it. Some word it along these lines, that it is God who preserves those who persevere by grace. And that's a helpful way of thinking about these things. That doesn't mean that we're overlooking the failings and the sins and the backslidings of God's people. You'll always have the Davids and the Peters and individuals of that nature and of that rank. But you'll look at the Davids and the Peters, and what are you going to see? You're going to see the times in which they grievously sinned. But remember, there's a whole lifetime. And you see David coming out of his sin, confessing it, renewing himself. And you see Peter again getting back to the Lord, don't you? And what do you see? You see, even though there's a falling. By the way, there is a holding fast in the grace of God, which is true of both of these men, enables them to keep on going to the end. And they press on and they persevere, because on one hand, it is God who has saved and preserves them, and he's put his spirit within them. And one of the evidences of this is that they will hold fast. So that word "if" is not making it conditional. He's not saying, you know, you're saved only if you do this. But he's saying your salvation is manifest in this way, if you hold fast. It's a fruitful, living, vibrant, steadfast Christianity. Really important for us to understand that. The complete absence of perseverance in the Christian life is evidence that no justification ever took place. Now, I would never sit someone down. It's not my place. It's not my authority to point out someone and say, well, they're not a Christian, they're not saved. But listen, we've also got to get away from this notion of someone that just makes a glib profession and has no life whatsoever. And then we just go through and say, well, that person's backslidden. We can't keep on going on like that. There has to be something. If it's at the beginning and a falling away, but just something. And that's what Paul is talking about here. I mean, you can't deny this, by which you're saved if you manifest this holding fast of what I preached unto you. Because he goes on to say, unless you've believed in vain, unless it's just all a farce, unless you've just, you know, you don't really believe the things in the first place, it's just all a showpiece. It's time really to start nailing the colours to the mast here, because you're in a situation where it's confusing everyone. So he says, stand up and come out among them and hold fast. Are you saved? Live like it. Believe it and go on with God. The complete absence of perseverance in the Christian life is evidence. No justification whatsoever. Because the ones whom God justifies, he's going to sanctify and he's going to glorify. Remember how John writes about this? It must have been heartbreaking for John when he said this. 1 John 2 verse 9, they went out from us. They went out from us. Honest words. Why did they go out from you, John? What happened, John? Didn't they make a profession? It isn't just the fact they've fallen away and, you know, they'll come back. And John says, they went out from us. They were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have no doubt have continued with us. That's hard. It's hard hitting. It's searching. We'll be very careful and delicate in how we apply that, but it's reality. He goes on to say, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. Sometimes people leave the Christian church and they are saved and they are backslidden, and we pray them back and God will bring them back, and whether it's our church or another church, may God do a work. It may well be they've just never been saved. That's a hard thing, isn't it? But it's all bound up in what he's saying here. Now this, I believe, is Paul's message. And if these false teachers, Paul is saying, are correct, then there is no resurrection. And if there's no resurrection, then we have an ineffectual, pointless faith, and there's no need to persevere. That's where we're going to go in this message. The point of Paul is this. If you deny the resurrection of the dead, you're going to deny hand in hand Christ has risen from the dead. And if there's no raising of Christ, there is no point to what we're doing. It's a vain religion. It's pointless. And we believe for no reason. Let's go home. But he says, that's not the case. Christ is risen from the dead. There is a resurrection of the dead. This is reality. Believe it. Live it out. Go on with God. Hold fast. Unless you really think this is not true. It's a call to search yourself. It's a call to sift. You see it? And that means what Paul has done is he set himself up for one of the most absorbing and most fascinating letters or chapters we have in Holy Scripture. And you know what? In the day in which we live, it's all the more appropriate and applicable. What a word to our souls this evening. A very simple thing, isn't it? To hold fast that which we have believed. And may the Lord give me and you grace in these days to do that very thing. May he bless his precious truth to our hearts. Amen. Amen.